Good evening and welcome to the Black Stack, the second keynote of this year's Transmediale conference program. All in the glow, in the afterglow. And tonight it's the keynote of our conference stream, an afterglow of the Mediatic. We also have the streams Hashes to Ashes. We had the keynote event of that yesterday. And on Sunday at 6, we have the final keynote session, Will You Be My Treasure, with Sputniko. But tonight, we are discussing an afterglow of the Mediatic with Benjamin Bratton and Metahaven, and specifically the notion of the stack. This will be introduced, this session, by one of the chairs of the stream, Ryan Bishop, who together with Jussi Parikka from the Winchester School of Art at the University of Southampton helped us put together specifically this stream of the conference. I will give the word over to Ryan Bishop, but before that, I just want to say also thanks to our funders of the conference program, the Bundeszentrale für politische Bildung, and I wish you a nice evening in the company of the Black Stack.
Thank you, Christopher. I'm going to be very brief because the presenters have developed their own introduction to the session and to the keynote. Just to follow up very briefly, though, I want to stop the proceedings for just 1 second and to have us take a moment to thank Christopher in the appropriate way for all of the hard work he's done for a fabulous Transmediale this year. The Winchester School of Art is very honored to be a partner with Transmediale, and we're very proud of the stream that we've developed for this year's iteration of the festival. We've already had one event on the uses and abuses of big data. Now we have the keynote. Tomorrow in the morning, we have some students from Winchester School of Art who will be doing a reiteration, a restaging of the famous This Is Tomorrow exhibition from London. And we have a session in the afternoon on the deep time of media written on the earth and written on the skin, which will feature Jussi Parikka, my co-curator for this particular stream, and Sean Cubitt and Denise Akira, which promises to be quite a great session. And then the day ends quite late at night with an artist conversation between Trevor Paglen and myself. So hope to see all of you at some, if not all, of those events. The idea behind this stream was to try to have a kind of continuity between last year's program, back when Pluto was a planet, and to take up the longer term trajectories, temporal trajectories, of media, and to think these things through in ways that are not constrained by presentist concerns and myopia. And I think we have succeeded in doing so. I cannot think of any more interesting academician to think through how polyscalar systems of the Earth are creating a new nomos than Benjamin Bratton. I can think of no more interesting design team than Metahaven to evoke the design elements, intended and unintended, of how these polyscalar systems operate together. So once again, let me say thank you to them and introduce Benjamin and Metahaven.
Okay, thank you, Ryan, for the introduction. This joint presentation is the next, I think, fourth, fifth, in a series of conversations between Metahaven and myself on the idea of the stack that I develop in a forthcoming book called The Stack on Software and Sovereignty. And these conversations are drawn really from a kind of mutual preoccupation with the geopolitics of planetary scale computation, and more specifically how it distorts and deforms the traditional Westphalian models of political geography, jurisdiction, sovereignty, and produces new territories in its own image. Now, my interest in terms of this book, draws specifically from Carl Schmitt's work on the nomos of the Earth and his, albeit flawed, history of the geometries of geopolitical architectures. So Nomos refers to the dominant or essential logic for the political subdivisions of the earth, land, seas, air, and domain that the US military now simply calls cyber, and for the geopolitical order that stabilizes accordingly. Now, today, as the nomos of the horizontal loop geometry of the modern state creaks and groans, and as seeing like a state takes leave of its initial territorial nest, both with and against the demands of planetary scale computation, we wrestle with a chaotic delamination of effective sovereignty from the deep occupation of place, and the emergence of irregular abstractions of information, time, and territory. And for this, a nomos of the cloud would draw jurisdiction not only by the horizontal subdivision of physical sites, by and for states, but also by the vertical stacking of interdependent layers on top, two geometries sometimes in cahoots, sometimes completely diagonal and unrecognizable to one another.
Do we have the image up?
Yeah.
Ah, great, there it is, the stack. So planetary scale computation takes several different forms and different scales. Energy and mineral sourcing in grids, cloud infrastructure, urban software, public service privatization, massive universal addressing systems, interfaces drawn by the augmentation of the hand, of the eye, or dissolved into objects, users both overdetermined by self-quantification and exploded by the arrival of legions of non-human users, sensors, cars, and robots. And instead of seeing all those various species of contemporary computational technologies as so many different genres of machines spinning out on their own, we should see them instead as forming the body of an accidental megastructure. Perhaps these align layer by layer into something not unlike a vast, if also incomplete, pervasive, if also irregular software and hardware stack. The model is of a stack that both does and does not exist as such. It is a machine that serves as a schema, as much as a schema of machines. As such, perhaps the image of a totality that such a conception provides would, as theories of totality always have before, make the composition of new governmentalities and new sovereignties both more legible and more effective. The stack, in short, is that new nomos of a vertically thickened political geography. The book that Ben is has written, describes the six layers of the stack to be read from bottom to top: Earth, cloud, city, address, interface, and user. And tonight, instead of demonstrating each layer and of the stack as a whole, Ben and Metahaven, Vinka and I, agreed to do the less prudent thing and instead to articulate some possible futures, even recommended designs for these layers and for the totality, or better, for the next totality, the nomos to come.
And so the black stack, our title, is to the stack what the shadow of the future is to the present time. The black stack is less the anarchist stack or the death metal stack or the utterly opaque stack than a computational totality to come, which is defined at this moment by what it's not, by the empty content fields of its framework, as well as by its dire inevitability. It's not the platform we have, but the platform that might be, defined by the productivity of accidents and by the strategy that what first appears to be most bad may ultimately be where to look for the way out, less a possible future than an escape from the present. And so, the rest is Daniel will make a presentation, and then I'll make my own. So it's my pleasure to hand the talking stick to Daniel and Metahaven.
Thanks, Ben. All right, so so here's another version of that stack that places some sort of graphic emphasis. It's not really not the emphasis of the talk, but we thought it looked slightly better than the blue stack. This is really like being given the key to Ben's multi-million-dollar Californian Richard Neutra home and being asked to take care of the plants. because Ben is a accomplished.
I don't really have this home.
I know you don't have that home, but if you had that home, this lock would look like this. It would be an electronic cloud lock. Mm-hmm. So instead of we're graphic designers primarily, although we do have a very deep interest in theory and things like that. So but it means that we address issues that that come on the table, like the ones in the stack, primarily not just by theorizing about them, but also like through our work. So when we make something, it always seems like we have to go through something, and that's a kind of process where we sort of digest and work with these notions visually, like as designers, makers, etc. So that's going to be largely going from like bottom to top through the stack, this new political, potentially new political geography. Right. So this is a concept car. And we start at Earth, right? This is where we presently live. It's the ground beneath the Haus of world cultures. And it's a prerequisite of any ground on which any argument can be made between people, if that argument is going to have political consequences. Mostly conservatives and realists love the earth, liberals love the cloud, communists love fire, and pirates love water. So we could say a lot about the division between land and sea, but we're on a limited time here. There is a whole history of the way that the sea has been opposed to the land as some sort of free space that's sort of unregulated. We seem to have gotten rid of that largely, and now it seems like the internet sometimes has come to figure for us as this sort of free space, right? But I'm also really inclined to think of this proposal that was issued a couple of months ago to shut off the NSA's water supply. It's a proposal launched by ultra conservatives in the United States that figure that the state level government doesn't need to provide for resources that to organizations that actually breach the Constitution, like the NSA. So their proposal is, you have no water, you have no data center. And that is a very, very powerful proposition, we think, because it sort of averts even, the making of an argument pro or con. You basically say, you have this massive behemoth infrastructure and you can shut it off basically by not giving it water, which is sort of this, the way that the earth works for the stack, basically. So this is not an NSA data center. This is the so-called berm wall. The berm wall is located in the Western Sahara, and it's built by the Moroccan army to keep a people out of their country and into the desert, the people of the Western Sahara. And it, as a structure, it is a sort of hybrid between a man-made and a natural structure, though it's neither discussed by CNN, neither by National Geographic. It really sits in between, which amounts to the invisibility of the conflict of the Western Sahara. And recently, Fink and I have had some conversations with people that want to change that situation. So we figure that actually from the ground up, you can sort of think, up and up and up, and basically what you get is the stack. So basically this kind of bare space that doesn't have any internet, doesn't have almost nothing, implies the stack on every layer. So these are drafts, sketches for a new project that's currently being, in development, where basically the last layer, the earth layer, is always Western Sahara. And the proposal also tries to deal with the notion that many of the sort of more liberal audiences don't really know what Western Sahara is, because you have already too much other Kony 2012 type of issues to worry about. So this is a sort of stack-approved Kony 2012 in the making. Right. So this is an Icelandic volcano exploding in 2010. Disrupting the whole European airspace. And this is, no one can pronounce the name of this volcano, and it's printed in Gothic type on the top left side of your screen. But basically this explosion could be read as some sort of revenge of nature over the economy. because the ash cloud immobilized a very large chunk of European air traffic, there with the economy, there with our security, etc., etc. So this could be called a terrorist act, but it's not. It's nature. And we're arguing this is not just real, but also symbolic. You know, it's the disturbance of things as they are, a parallel to Iceland's response to the financial crisis, a cloud made real, internet as a geology. So that, keep that in mind, the idea that this could also constitute some sort of business model, which would mean not from hashes to ashes, but from ash to cash. So we're going to talk about cloud and city all in one sort of layer, so we're not going to split the layers apart too much. You see a man mounting an antenna. The notion of the cloud, as we know it, is basically a designed fiction to make the notion of where your data is abstract. So it's basically an abstraction of what the internet used to be. And the first mention of the word cloud in relation to the internet was in 1996 in this obscure diagram from an MIT research paper, where you got two originating networks, you got an originating network and a receiving network. In the middle, you have a cloud of intermediate networks. So basically, when you don't really know what's inside, you call it a cloud. And it turns out that this kind of great sort of sales technique to basically sell the ubiquity of data. So people that know our work a little bit do know that we're highly critical of the cloud. It's not because we're like regressive and want to go back to, you know, having only your sort of own server with you at all times, but also because we think that the way that this cloud is solved is basically making people stupid. Well, this relates to the shift on the internet from something which was called by someone the cypherpunk dream to like something called data's empire, which is a shift from less control to more control, and from anonymity to real name, and all those familiar shifts by now. Also affecting the notion of net neutrality, which is basically we can sort of shelve now that notion, because in a kind of app world there is no net neutrality. It's a highly curated world, and Steve Jobs, no longer with us today, is the sort of chief curator. He's the sort of the name an important curator. There are lots of them, I know, right? Like he's the most powerful one of the cloud, of the app store. Right, so you could say that like a sort of apple.gov governmentality is emerging. So, in this case, we're really interested in this notion of decentralization of data. Data decentered, the idea, the problem is not the cloud or the internet. The problem is that everything is united in one entity. You know, even if we're possible argument here between us and Benjamin is like the notion if Google, starts some sort of, extrajudicial project, it's still a Google project, which makes it still centralized under like a mega corporation, like saying like Coca-Cola.
Of course.
Yeah, okay. But possible alternatives, like Iceland was one, place where it seemed that an alternative was forming, in the sense that they tried to think about a more localized notion of the internet, and that led us to propose together with IMI, Icelandic Modern Media Initiative, to the Icelandic government a promo campaign for the Icelandic cloud. And it seems like listening to the talk yesterday, the keynote here with Laura Poitras and Jake Applebaum and Trevor Paglen, it seems that Germany is now running away with this model of like this kind of secure space where people actually do care, etc. So it was a sort of little bit of a missed opportunity for Iceland in that case. But we did have some fun preparing these proposals, such as in which they grow tomatoes by organic internet, which basically stands for the fact that, with the data center heat, you can grow food in Iceland and all that. So it's a sort of highly ecological cloud at the same time. Then we started to also think about making, more insightful the actual physical infrastructure, like the data lending points. How is Iceland connected to the rest of the world? And they have names like Denise and Faroes, because Denise is Denmark and Iceland. Faroes is Faroe Islands and Iceland. So they become this kind of persons. They become this kind of robots in the global, infrastructure, in the global connectivity. Then as the campaign sort of half failed, we started to think about the NSA issues and the way that Edward Snowden had to sort of be carried around the world, much like, data is actually kept out of certain jurisdictions. So that led to Tinker Tailor Soldier Skype. And now you were supposed to see Anna Chapman, the spy. She might come up later. These are proposals for data centers that we develop that deal with decentralized data storage. For example, this one deals with data that's half stored in Norway, half stored in Russia, which is sort of really a border of two worldviews, as it were. But Norway is itself far away, far enough removed from the kind of European Union type of worldview so that it also constitutes some sort of, you know, independence or some sort of more, you know, agency. At least in our, we always hope that Scandinavia has this big promise for us still. And this is the Norwegian side of that data center. Of course, we could take that much further, talking about failed states and talking about the notion of setting up critical infrastructure in areas that are less governed, that are less determined by belonging or submitting to the norms of international relations and all that. So this was one of these proposals. And actually, our recent film, Black Transparency, deals with this too. So it starts, these are just some stills from that, you know, short film that we recently made. So you start in, you know, it starts in Athens and it ends with some, there's lava. This is a great stack metaphor because it's the earth, the sort of layers of the earth melting and coming together. This is a sort of image for the whistleblower, thinking of Chelsea Manning and Edward Snowden, who's been mentioned before many times. And here's that an image that we use in that film of some sort of electrified, completely computerized home where every mirror and every surface is actually a screen, and everything pops up messages of appointments and calls and everything. It's a sort of dream of like interactive glass, which is pretty much the sort of a dream that seems to identify with all the ideals of transparency, but in fact does the opposite, because all the technology that's needed to power these like these glass surfaces is sort of the abstraction. You know, it's something to think that we really don't know how it works. But this woman actually enjoys it, and she lives in that world, which is actually not so far removed from this notion of the data storage as with the NSA. These are the children of Kim.com. as they play on the beach, and finally we end up in this film in a desert, which is somewhere near you soon, where there is, it turns out, there is some sort of basic connectivity there, and it's a kind of utopian, almost utopian proposition about life, basically. Rather than taking a very let's say evidence-based view on art or artistic practice surrounding transparency, internet rights, etc., we also like to take up a view that's slightly more dramatized and fictionalized sometimes. So there you go again with your data center. So address the next layer in the stack. Right, Benjamin knows much more about this than we do. So all we had to say about address in this talk is basically the fact that you have all these smart applications like Kitchen Mentor, but they become Prism. They become this sort of rich trove that can be looked into. So the idea that everything should become smart, and that every object and every action and every entity and every thought should have an IP address, also makes that thought or that entity or that fridge or that kitchen traceable in this kind of network of connections that you might want to sort of harvest for, the 3 hops or the 10 hops of the NSA. So that, you might say that coming soon to the Internet of Things is Dropmeyer, which is so close to Dropbox. Dropmeyer is the spying program, the NSA, that spies on foreign embassies. So it's hilariously close to, our conveniently intrusive cloud storage system, Dropbox. So this is basically our view on address, but Benjamin is going to be much more nuanced on this, and is going to say us much more, interesting and deep things about this. Interface. We're not ashamed to say that we're sort of the interior decorators of transparency, in the sense that we as a design group have worked for quite some time with WikiLeaks now to design for them some sort of garments like scarves and t-shirts and all that, that the sales of which and the visibility of which are helping to avert the banking blockade from which they suffer since some time. But before we go into that, let's just go into interface now. Hello, Ghost Modernity. Snapchat, a very, very interesting smartphone application that that does not just provide another service, but it provides you with the ability, as you undoubtedly know, to send pictures, and they are being displayed for 10 seconds maximum, and then they disappear from the phone. And it turns out that, you know, although that was an idea that came up pretty, you know, brazenly just in some Stanford dorm, there is now actually theoretical backup for that idea with the notion of ephemeral social media. And ephemeral social media take as their starting point that instead of these kind of overarching identities to establish these sort of overarching identities for users, it tries to instead work much more with the way that, that social media work as part of daily behavior, let's say. So instead of like being like the Google, the Amazon, the Facebook that wants to like own like all of your life, it just wants to facilitate a certain social space. This is not an ad for Snapchat, but definitely that something's moving on that field. So in this little thing that we made, we compared Snapchat with Lebeuse Woods, H.R. Geiger, Azealia Banks, Voivod, and Miley Cyrus. Thinking of the notion of demolishing and destruction and deconstruction as somehow related to this. So to come back to WikiLeaks' familiar story for some of you perhaps, but the idea that, that you could do design for WikiLeaks or with WikiLeaks was something that inspired us for a very long time. So we've started out with thinking about their, you know, visual identity, as we call it as graphic designers, and it turned out, of course, that they had no need for a visual identity because they already had one, which was designed by a college friend of, a university friend of Julian Assange. Instead, we started to create these garments. And the argument behind this is that there is a real need for, let's say, visual practices that are, you know, not like ultimately very hyper-reductive in their visual nature to be connected to things like transparency and political activism on the internet, so that we need a very, we feel we need a very rich and ambitious, you know, visual gesture rather than this sort of sad, ultra minimalistic idea like, okay, this is a serious issue, so we should like not design at all, we should just be really plain. So this is one installation seen from the back. These are other scarves, so for us it's really inspiring, and we love to design in a way that's visually a little bit more richer narrative. I don't know what qualities or non-qualities you could give to it. And of course these products work on a level of soft power too. In the sense that they're not hard political manifestos, but they're layered images. They're almost like partially transparent, partially opaque, etc. Similarly for Bitcoin, for Silk Road. Well, this is Twitter, but here you see some Earth, some geography, to ultimately remind us of the stack that we're almost through now. Ending up at the user, the top of the stack. Of course, users can be defined as consumers. That is how they have been defined primarily in the last 20 years or so. But we would like to launch our new slogan for our new book, Black Transparency, and that slogan is, the personal is geopolitical. So in the 70s in Amsterdam, you had this slogan, the personal is political, which meant that every kind of personal issue regarding the way you live, the way you eat, with whom you live, who you love, if you have children or not, why, if you're married, all those issues become politicized. Because, you know, politics is ultimately the question of how do we organize our life together. And Right now, you could say that the personal is geopolitical because it's up to certain people to take decisions or to do things that have consequences that run right through the stack, and that, you know, that, and that may be taken at the level of the user or the level of the person, but that run just right through that stack and basically end up influencing what the whole stack looks like. And unlike in maybe previous decades, those people do not need to have a lot of power when they start. Like here we see Edward Snowden sitting on a Russian chair. Edward Snowden, obviously, you know, we could depict him as the NSA whistleblower, which he is, but he was a temporary freelance contractor for the NSA. So in other words, all the issues about, you know, temporary labor, like the disappearance of fixed jobs, the disappearance of, you know, the permanent and eternal loyalty to certain organizations, the permeability of the walls of organizations, all that stuff is sort of inscribed in the way that Edward Snowden worked for the NSA, because he was not like this sort of veteran, you know, 35 years of service person who worked for this agency. No, he was basically a freelancer. So from that notion of immaterial labor and neoliberal, like the kind of neoliberal model behind like the restructuring of labor, it's a very interesting moment. And so he is, of course, a key example of someone of whom you could say he proves that now the personal is geopolitical. And there's many other examples. So I want to end this Metahaven segment of the joint talk with playing a piece of film that's about another stack. Basically, it's about us people and another stack. And that stack is the models that were made by Constant Nieuwenhuis, Dutch artist and architect, member of the Situationist International of New Babylon, which was a city that he constructed, theorized as a futurity of society where, you know, play would dominate. Basically, this film, which is largely about a subject that, you know, we seldomly talk about in these contexts, the subject of love, basically argues that through, you know, our the way that we deal with networks, the way that we're connected, you know, with our smartphones, and you know, the kind of constant sort of yearning and the constant sort of anxiety that it produces, we have created some sort of new Babylon, but only not in the way that it was intended. So I'm going to play a segment of that film. These are just stills from that film. So you see that, like, there's models of Constant New Babylon. There's other stuff happening in the back. And now I really hope that this goes without any sort of the infamous technical problems. There we go.
It is often said that we no longer have an addressee for our political demands. But that's not true. We have each other. What we can no longer get from the state, the party, the union, the boss, we ask for from one another. And we provide. Someone once defined love as giving something you don't have to someone who doesn't want it. We start to see love's fullness and endless bounty as based in emptiness and lack, in mutual loss. Love's joy is not to be found in fulfillment, but in recognition. Even though I can never return what was taken away from you, I may be the only person alive who knows what it is. I don't have what it is you're missing, but knowing its shape already makes a world where you can live without it. Love is a union based in mutual debt. When the debt is paid off or called in, the union dissolves. And now that everyone is in debt, love abounds. We are moving back in with our parents. We are returning home to our countries to depend on our extended families. Our contracts are backed by our personal relationships and by the trust and intimacy that gives them their character. Shared associations and affinities expressed over communication lines produce life rafts of value on an otherwise lonely ocean of data streams. Musicians record songs without ever thinking about a record contract. Now we produce music as pure communication. Overstimulation and impoverishment have fallen in love with each other. They shack up together on an unemployed person's Facebook page. Neighborhood currencies appear to keep goods and services moving as the state breaks down. The currency could be a stone or a handshake. All that is capital melts into love. The collapse of welfare state fortresses coincided with the dissolution of the public. Together, immigration and trade etched away at the identitarian foundations of many nation states that would happily subsidize a thriving and healthy public sphere, only as long as it closely resembled conservative family love. We are no longer talking about work or capital, but about the distribution of vital energies that surpass economic calculus. Now that we live a constant slump, biopolitics lines up with pre-capitalist, pre-mercantile ways of stabilizing exchanges. The shifting of labor into the private sphere is a reallocation of resources from the workplace to the bedroom, a sliding of troubles from the office or the factory to the home, the marriage, the relationship, the mind, the children. Every day is bring your kid to work day, as well as never take a shower or change out of your pajamas day. Under the auspices of love, a new generosity form has emerged. Through the family, the lover, the market, the street, a machine of reciprocity now stretches horizontally from horizon to distant horizon, across a flat landscape, converting labor into love, and love back into labor. Converting love from a promise into a curse, and then back into a promise. This could be the end of economics, replaced by love. The transition might be a bit bumpy at first, but maybe it won't be such a bad thing in the long run. It will be disastrous for your relationship, but how can you complain when you are witnessing the phasing out of work and its replacement by love? The question of love is the phantom hanging over the question of work. It is also what comes after work. Now love becomes a figure of total depletion, of giving oneself away to the point of exhaustion and humiliating defeat. We look a mess because we have given our love in the absolute to the absolute. We have nothing left to give. When in love, giving and receiving have no calculus. They have infinite supply and demand. Just as in lovemaking, giving pleasure and receiving pleasure are indistinguishable from each other, to the extent that they are, in fact, no different. Kisses and compliments cost nothing and mean everything. Love abounds on information networks. Like a home, every inbox is a symphony of emotions, of simple pleasures, seething frustrations, of unconditional support and permanent disavowals, of silent treatments and gushing confessions. The internet has a material base that makes it subject to scarcity, national boundary policing, and state surveillance. It's totally true. But don't be misled into thinking that the materiality of the internet fully accounts for what it is doing to us. It is the emotional content. Misspelled names in emails, trigger-happy responses, and breakneck turnaround times lead to a psychotic swamp of effect. We are made for each other. We have so much in common. Love becomes a society without the state.
All right, I'll leave it here with the user. So we're going to go back to the stack with Benjamin.
Thank you, Daniel.
Thank you.
Good, so we're going to switch to here, yeah? Okay. So I'm going to use the advantage of batting last to extend our discussion up to the edge of the deep end and hopefully a little bit over. There's several versions of my talks about the Stack Project online where I elucidate each of these layers in detail. And so, and this is also going to be the basis of a course that I'm doing at European Graduate School in June. So tonight I thought I would rather speak to the occasion and put the schema of the stack to work a bit by writing something specific to this. And I'm really a writer, so text is my prime way in which I can communicate most precisely. So you'll forgive my prosthesis here. The platforms of the cloud, the platforms of the cloud layer suggest weird, dense, plural geographies and non-contiguous geometries of geography, mixing USA super jurisdiction with aspects of charter cities, which would carve new, partially privatized polities from the whole cloth of de-sovereign lands. But perhaps there's more there. The immediate geographical drama of the cloud layer is seen perhaps most directly in the ongoing Sino-Google conflicts of 2008 to the present. China hacking Google, Google pulling out of China, NSA hacking China, NSA hacking Google, Google ghostwriting books on behalf of the State Department, Google wordlessly circumventing the last instances of state oversight altogether, not by transgressing them, but by absorbing them into their service offering. The geographies at work here are quite weird. For example, Google filed a series of patents on offshore data centers to be built in international waters on towers using tidal currents and available water to keep the servers cool. And so the complexities of jurisdiction suggested by a global cloud piped in from non-state space are fantastic, but they are less exceptional than exemplary, perhaps, of a new normal. Between China and Google, there's more than a standoff between the two proxies of two state apparatuses, rather a basic conflict over the geometry of political geography itself, one bound by the territorial integrity of the state and the other by the gossamer threads of the world's information demanding to be organized and to be made useful, as the saying goes. This basic conflict between two logics of governance, two geometries of territory, one a subdivision of the horizontal, the other a stacking of vertical layers, one a state, one a parastate, one superimposed on top of the other at any point on the map, never resolving into some consensual cosmopolitanism, but continuing to grind against the grain of each other's planes. This characterizes, I think, the geopolitics of our moment, that plus generalized secession, but the two are perhaps interrelated. So from here, I think it's easy to see that contemporary cloud platforms are displacing, if not replacing, the traditional core function of states. And in this, these para-state platforms demonstrate new spatial and temporal models of politics and public, for good and ill. Archaic states drew authority from the regular provision of food, and over the course of modernization, more has been added to the intricate bargains of Leviathan. Energy, infrastructure, legal identity and standing, objective and comprehensive maps, credible currencies, and flag brand loyalties. Bit by bit, each of these and more are now provided by cloud platforms, not necessarily as a formal replacement for state versions, but like Google ID, simply more useful and effective for daily life. The terms of participation, of course, are not mandatory, and for this, more extractive. This cloud polis draws revenue from the cognitive capital of its users who trade attention and microeconomic compliance in exchange for global infrastructural services, and in turn, it provides each of them an active discrete identity and license to use that infrastructure. That said, it's clear, I think, that we don't have anything like a proper geopolitical theory of these transformations and rotations. Before, the full ambition of the USA security apparatus was, as it seems today, more plain. It was thought by many, for example, that the cloud was a place where states had no ultimate competence, or maybe even a role to play. Too slow, too dumb, too easily outwitted by using the right browser. States would be cored out, component by component, until nothing is left but a well-armed insurance scheme with its own World Cup team. In the long run, that may still be the outcome. Modern liberal states taking their place next to ceremonial monarchs, stripped of all but symbolic authority, not necessarily replaced, but displaced and misplaced to one side. But now we hear the opposite, equally brittle conclusion, that the cloud is only the state, equals the state. Its totality, both figural and potential, is intrinsically totalitarian. Despite all, I wouldn't take that bet. Now, looking toward the black stack, we observe that new forms of governmentality arise through new capacity to tax flows at ports, at gates, on property, on income, on attention, on clicks, on movement, on electrons, on carbon. And it's not at all clear whether, in the long run, cloud platforms will overwhelm state control on these flows, or whether states will continue to evolve themselves into cloud platforms, absorbing those displaced functions back into themselves. Whether both will split or rotate diagonal to one another, how deeply what we may now recognize as the surveillance state in the USA or China will become some universal solvent of compulsory transparency and or a cosmically opaque megastructure of absolute paranoia, or both. So finally, is the state, the market, or the platform better designed to tax the interfaces of everyday life? A false choice to be sure, but it raises the question of where to even locate the site of governance as such. What would it mean, what would we mean by the public, if not that which is constituted by those interfaces? Where else should governance, meant as the most plastic and necessary sense of deliberate composition of durable systems and conditions, subjects and mediations, live, if not there? Not in some obtuse chain of parliamentary representation, nor some delusional monadic individual unit, nor some sad little community consensus powered by moral hectoring, but instead in the imminent, immediate, exactly present interfaces that cleave and bind us. Where should sovereignty reside if not in what binds us and cleaves us? Not derived from each of us individually, but drawn by what is in between us. And for this, I think it's critical to underscore that cloud platforms, including sometimes state apparatuses, are exactly that, platforms. It's important as well to underscore that platforms are not only a technical architecture, but an institutional form as well. At once, they centralize like states, scaffolding the terms of participation according to rigid but universal protocols, just as they decentralize like markets, coordinating economies not through the superimposition of fixed plans, but through interoperable interaction. Next to states and markets, platforms are a third form, coordinating through fixed terms and scattering free-range users watched over in loving, if also disconcertingly omniscient, grace. In the platform as totality, drawing the interfaces of everyday life one into the other, the maximal state and the minimal state, Red Plenty and Google Ghost Plan, start to look weirdly similar. And as I see it, the work of political theory and design and geopolitics is to develop that proper history to typology and program for platforms. And from this, not merely a shorthand for cloud feudalism, nor for the network politics of the multitude, but rather for the organization of durable alter totalities, commanding the force of law, if not necessarily its form. And from this, our subjective enrollment is less as the citizen of the polis, nor as homo economicus, but positioned as user within the platform. Now, one of the useful paradoxes of the user as a political subject position is its contradictory forces towards both artificial over-individuation and ultimate pluralization, both participating differently in the geopolitics of transparency. For example, the whole quantified self movement in California, report more of a medical theology, is haunted by this contradiction. At first, the intensity and granularity of a new information mirror image comes to convince the user of his or her individuated coherency and stability as a subject. He is flattered by the singular beauty of his reflection. And this is why quantified self is so popular with those enamored by an X-Men reading of Atlas Shrugged. But as more data is added to the diagram that quantifies his interactions with the outside world, or that outside's impact on his person, the health of the microbial biome in his gut, immediate and long-term environmental conditions, his various epidemiological contexts, then the quality of everything that is not him comes to overcode and overwhelm any notion of himself as a withdrawn and self-contained agent. Like Theseus's paradox, where when every component of a thing has been replaced over and over, no original remains but the metaphysical husk. The user is confronted with the existential lesson that at any point, he is only the intersection of so many streams. At first, the subject position of the user overproduces individual identity, but in the continuance of the same mechanism, it then explodes it. Likewise, the geopolitics of the user we have now is inadequate, including, I think, many of its oppositionalist modes. The Oedipal discourse of privacy and transparency in relation to the evil eye of the uninvited stepfather is no doubt a necessary process towards an alter globalism, but it has real limits. A geopolitics of computation predicated at its core upon the biopolitics of privacy, of self-immunization from any compulsory appearance in front of publics, or platforms, or states, or others, can sometimes also serve as a psychological internalization of a now ascendant general economy of secession, castration anxiety, whatever. The pre-paranoia of withdrawal into the atomic and anomic dream of self-mastery that elsewhere we call the neoliberal subject. The space of the discursive formation of the subject, as well as the technical constitution of the user as a singular or plural agent, or both, is in fact a much larger horizon. Consider by way of example proxy users. UProxy is a project supported by Google Ideas, a browser modification that lets users easily pair across distances to allow someone in one location, trapped in the bad internets, to send information unencumbered through the position of another user in another location, someone who enjoys the good internets. You'll recall, of course, the proxy service set up during the Arab Spring and see how Google Ideas, which is Jared Cohen's group, might take special interest in baking this into the platform. For Sino-Google geopolitics, the platform could theoretically be available at a billion user scale to those who live in China, even if Google is not technically in China, because those users acting through and as foreign proxies are themselves, as far as the internet geography is concerned, both in and not in China. Developers of UProxy believe that it would take two simultaneous and synchronized man-in-the-middle attacks to hack the link, and at population scale, that would prove difficult, even for the best state actors, for now. Metadata, as we know, is perhaps another matter. But such a framework could, of course, be just as easily to withdraw data from a site that, for excellent reasons, should be left alone. Now, in principle, some plural user subject conjoined by a proxy link or other means could be composed of two humans in different countries, human and a sensor, sensor and a bot, human and a robot and a sensor, a whatever and a whatever. And in theory, any one of these subcomponents not only could be part of multiple conjoined positions, but might not even know or need to know always which meta user they contribute to, any more than the microbial biome in your gut needs to know your name. Spoofing with honeypot identities between humans and non-humans is just another point where the monadology of object-oriented ontology simply falls apart. Also, projected against the theoretical address space of IPv6 or some other massive universal addressing scheme, the quantity and range of things that could, in principle, participate in these pluralities, addressable persons, objects, even addressable massless relations between things, could be a sub-user in this internet of hiacities. So, while the stack and the black stack stage the death of the user in one sense, and with it the eclipse of a certain humanism, it does so because it also brings the multiplication and proliferation of other kinds of non-human users. Sensors, financial algorithms, robots, from nanometric to landscape scale, and or all of which one of us might enter into some relationship as one part of a composite user. And this is where the recent shift by major cloud platforms into robotics concerns may prove most important, as like Darwin's tortoises finding their way to different Galapagos islands, the Cambrian explosion in robotics sees speciation occur in the wild, not just in the lab, and with us on their inside, not on their outsides. As robotics and cloud hardware of all scales blend into the same category of things, it will be unclear in human-robotic interaction whether one is encountering a fully autonomous, partially autonomous, completely human, piloted synthetic intelligence. Everyday interactions replaying the Turing test over and over. Is there a person behind this, and if so, how much? In time, it will matter less. And the postulation of the human, or even carbon-based life, as the threshold measure of intelligence qualifying a subject as worthy of political ethics may seem like tasteless vestigial racism, replaced by much less anthropocentric frames of reference. The position of the user then maps only very incompletely onto one individual body. From the perspective of the platform, what looks like one may really be many, and what looks like many may only be one. And so, elaborate schizophrenias take hold on our early negotiation of these composite user positions. The neoliberal subject position makes absurd demands on people, as users, as quantified selves, as sysadmins of the psyche. And from this, paranoia and narcissism are two symptoms of the same disposition, two functions of the same mask. For one function, the mask works to pluralize identity according to the subjective demands of the user position as a composite alloy, and for another, to defend against those demands on behalf of an illusory integrity of self-identity fracturing around its existential core. Is that user anonymous because dissolved into the multitude, or anonymous because public identification threatens individual self-mastery, sense of authority, and social unaccountability? The former and the latter are two very different politics, making use of the same masks. But given the schizophrenic economy of the user, first over-individuated, and then multiplied and de-differentiated, it's not an unexpected or neurotic reaction at all. It is, however, fragile and inadequate. In the construction of user identity, in this aggregation of metadata that is both and is not specific to any one entity, there is an important way, no identity to deduce other than the pattern of interaction between these partial actors. We may find, perhaps ironically, that the user position of the stack has actually far less in common with the neoliberal form than some of the oppositionalist formats for political subjectivity that quite rightly hope to challenge and reform and resist the stack as it's currently configured. And so something like a digital bill of rights for users, for example, however pleasant in its cosmopolitan optimism, becomes a much more complicated and fragile and limited solution when the discrete identification of a user is both so heterogeneous and so fluid. For it, are all proxy composite users one user? Is anything with an IP address a user? If not, why not? If this throne is reserved for one species, humans, so when is it that any one animal of this species is being a user? When is it not? Any time that it generates information, is it a user? If so, that would in practice crisscross and trespass some of our most basic concepts of the political. And so for that reason alone, it may be a good place to start. And so in addition to a fortification of the user as a geopolitical subject, we require also in turn a redefinition of political subject in relation to the operations of the user, one that is based not on homo economicus or parliamentary liberalism or the will to secede into the moral safety of individual privacy withdrawing from coercion. Instead, it should focus on composing and elevating new sites of governance in the immediate suturing interfacial material between subjects, the stitches and the traces and the folds of interaction between bodies and things at a distance that congeal into different networks demanding very different kinds of platform sovereignty. I'll conclude with some thoughts then on the stack that we have and on the black stack, which is our generic metonym for alternative totalities. The stack we have is defined then not only by its form, layers and platforms and their interpolations, it is also content. And as is now painfully clear, its content is the content of our daily lives, now weaponized against us. The panopticon effect is where you don't know if you're being watched or not, and so you behave as if you are. The inverse panopticon effect is one in which you know you're being watched, but act as if you are not. This, I think, is today's surveillance culture, exhibitionism in bad faith. The emergence of stack platforms doesn't promise any solution or even distinctions between friend and enemy. On some dark day in the future, versus the Google Caliphate, the NSA may even become to be seen by some as the public option. At least it is accountable in principle to some parliamentary limits, they will say, rather than merely stockholder avarice and flimsy user agreements. Now, if we take for the sake of our story 9/11 and the rollout of the Patriot Act as the year zero for the USA's massive gathering, encapsulation, and digestion of online data that we are only now beginning to comprehend, and parallel projects in China and Russia, and yes, Europe are sure to come to light in time, then we could imagine the entirety of network communication for the last decade, the big haul, as one deep and wide digital simulation of the world, or some significant section of it. It's an archive, a library of the real. Its mere existence as the purloined property of the state, just as physical fact, is almost occult. Almost. Its geophilosophical profile, from the energy necessary to preserve it, to its governing instrumentality, understood both as a text, very large text, and as a machine with various utilities, well overflows available politics of software. Its story is much more Borges than Lawrence Lessig. Its fate is as well. Can it be destroyed? Is it possible to delete this simulation? Is it even desirable to do so? Is there a trash can big enough for the big delete? Even if the plug could be pulled on all future data hauls, surely there must be a backup as well, the identical double of the simulation, such that if we delete one, the other will be forever haunting history until rediscovered by future AI archaeologists interested in their own Paleolithic origins. Would we bury it even if we could? Would we need signs around, like those designed for the Yucca Mountain nuclear waste disposal site, warning off unknowable future excavations? Those of us lucky enough to be alive during this 15-year span would enjoy a certain illegible immortality, curious to whatever metacognitive entity pieces us back together by our online activities, both public and private, proud and furtive, each of us rising back centuries from now, each of us a little Ozymandias of cat videos and Pornhub. So, the black stack in relation to this could come to mean very different things. On the one hand, it would imply that this simulation is opaque and unmappable, not disappeared, but that the whole thing is ultimately redacted. It could imply that from the ruined fragments of this history that another coherency can be carved against the grain, even back to the deeper competency at and below the earth layer. Its blackness is also perhaps the surface of a world that can no longer be composed by addition because it is so absolutely full and overwritten and overdetermined that to add more is just so much more ink into the ocean. Instead of tabula rasa, this tabula plenis allows for creativity and figuration only by subtraction, like scratching paint from the canvas, by carving away, by death, by replacement. Now, the structural logic of the stack, of any stack, allows for the replacement of whatever occupies one layer with something else. And for this, the rest of the architecture can continue to function. The content of any layer, earth, cloud, city, address, interface, user, could be replaced, including the masochistic, hysterical fiction of the individual user, neoliberal and neo-other things both. While all the rest of the layers could remain intact as viable armature for global infrastructure. The stack is designed to be remade. That is its technical form. But unlike replacing copper wire with fiber optics in the transmission layer of TCP/IP, replacing one kind of user with another is more difficult. Today, we are doing it by adding more and more different kinds of things into the user position, as I've mentioned. We should, however, I think, allow for more comprehensive displacements, not just elevating things to the status of political subjects or technical agents, but of making way for an essentially post-human and ahuman position. In time, perhaps at the eclipse of the Anthropocene, the historical phase of Google Ghostplan will give way to some stateless platform for multiple strata of synthetic intelligence, biocommunication to settle into new continents of cyborg symbiosis, or perhaps instead, if nothing else, the carbon and energy appetite of this embryonic ecology will simply starve the host. In this drama, but hopefully not for the fabrication of the stack to come, black or otherwise, a certain humanism and humanity is still, however, at the center of the frame. The demand is always upon that sentience. The AI must care deeply about us specifically, as the subject and object of its knowing and its desire. The nightmare worse than that the big machine wants to kill you is that it sees you as irrelevant, not even a discrete thing to know about. Worse than being seen as an enemy is not being seen at all. The AI does not hate you, nor does it love you, but you are made out of atoms which it can use for something else. One of the integral accidents of the stack may be this anthrocidal trauma that shifts us from our design center as the author of the Anthropocene to a supporting actor role in the arrival of the post-Anthropocene. The black stack may also be black because we cannot see our own reflection in it. The accelerationist geopolitics that we discussed at the panel this last Wednesday, I think, is drawn by this inhuman and inhumanist cosmopolitanism. Pre-Cambrian flora changed into peat oil, changed into children's toys. Dinosaurs changed into birds, changed into headdresses. Computation itself into the next machine, stack into black stack. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have a little bit of time for Q&A. There are microphones positioned in the aisles. So if Anybody would like to ask questions, please step up to the microphone. Perhaps I'll take. Go ahead. No, go ahead. Yeah.
Benjamin, you talked a little bit about the binding imminence of user interfaces, and I'm wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on the theory of imminence and how it relates to user interfaces in our present day.
Yeah, thanks for the question. I had a chance to clarify. By interface, I don't mean necessarily graphical user interfaces. The way in which I use the concept of interface is as a state of something in which allows it to conjoin two things, to cause some kind of effect to happen at a distance. And I think it's important to understand that and the interfaciality of that thing is only partially intrinsic to its physical profile. Something, when it's entered into some chain of causation, takes on a capacity of interfaciality. Yeah. So what I'm simply saying is that instead of locating the terms of sovereignty, or whatever we want to call it later on down the lines, as something that's emanating from within the core of the nodes, maybe we locate it instead in the transitive terms of movement between them in this interfaciality, right? Which could mean a wide number of things. Yeah.
Could you reference some real world examples for us to sort of illustrate?
Of which exactly? Of interfaciality or of what a governance model based on the interfaciality might imply?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I think there's, you could use this basic idea of a foregrounding of the edge over the node, a lot of different kinds. It's a topological transformation rather than something that has its own necessary kind of content within a particular situation. So I don't know that that would be actually so helpful to sort of do this. But let me actually answer the question by circling back to the first thing you were saying about graphical user interfaces. And let's take augmented reality technologies, for example, something I talk about in here as well. I happen to think the potential for these kinds of technologies is always wonderful and sort of things like this, but also quite potentially quite dangerous. And the reason I sort of think this is that I think that the superimposition, the subtitling of perceptual reality, the overlay by which the perception and cognition, the distance between the collapsing of the space of interpretation, will demonstrate that the real key use cases for augmented reality technologies like this are not advertising, not games. It would be fundamentalist religion. I think that the Abrahamic monotheisms that we have and the ones that we're yet to invent won't be able to resist the capacity to collapse the space of interpretation of sacred text directly onto the object field, the cleaving of sacred and profane, us and them, friend and enemy, so forth and so on. And I think it's this literalization of the object of that superimposition that will provide for its theological character in this regard. But I hope I've made the distinction between that and a general, this sort of general condition of interfaciality as such.
Yeah. Other questions?
Very simple question, I think. I just wonder to, or could you follow up on the position of the public as being that which is formed on the interfaces in these interstices in relation to this mainframe or these kind of new frameworks of sovereignty? Because it sounds like it's subsumed within this formation of the stack, and I'm trying to understand what the kind of social, theoretical, conceptual, but also normative role of this public is when it's linked to this new formations of subjectivity that this model proposes.
Well, as I think it said to the last person, I think this is an open question. I don't have a 10-point plan for what must be done in relation to this. Simply an observation that part of this observation and this rotation, I think that that's delamination, perforation, transformation of the location of sovereign position away from this sort of bound, these bounded positions towards certain kinds of transitive forms. I mean, you know, one way to see this is simply a kind of a shift in a figure ground relationship between the bounded form in the terms of the transitive engagement between them with it as such. So I mean it as an open question, as a provocation. Sort of, I believe that, you know, an argument can be made that this figure ground relationship is predominant in many cases, and we don't know what to do. We don't know what to do about it. Which for me, you know, we don't know the answer to this question that you're posing. I think that's why I'm posing it is in this way. So, you know, I think it's a critical one. But yeah.
I have to admit, I'm getting a little bit lost in your language, and I wanted to ask you a question that might relate to somebody who's, I don't think he's in the room. And obviously he's not on the panel with you, but the Nigerian artist yesterday, Jalili, who wrapped himself up in electronic waste and saran wrap, and then was for 30 minutes trying to escape that dilemma. And I just wonder if you could attempt to, what you've been trying to describe here in a language to this performance artist in Nigeria, how is he going to cut himself out of this dilemma?
Thank you. So it's actually quite a good question. I don't know that I have a knife for him either. But I will maybe rearticulate the condition. That it sounds, I didn't see this performance. It sounds like he's sort of implying here. I was on a panel. I was mentioning this to someone earlier. I was on a panel a few years ago with a guy named Stanley Williams, who's a computer scientist at Hewlett Packard. And almost as an offhand remark, he told this story about how he was put on a panel with then Vice President Gore, with the brief was, could we invent a supercomputer that could actually model the climate in real time? What would it take to do that? So this was the assignment of this group to do. And as the best they figured out, it would take zeta flop computation, something we don't sort of have yet, but it also its energy appetite would be sort of enormous. And what he ended with was like, what we figured out was that the computer necessary to do this would be roughly the size of Paris, and that it itself would be the most significant energy event that it itself would be modeling. And I think it's this. I think this recursivity is allegorical, if you like, for the energy politics of the stack, which I see as a sort of Ouroboros, the snake eating its own tail. Right? We want to build a smart grid, something like this, by which we can keep the industrial modernity going. We realize that the carbon and energy necessary to build that infrastructure that would in fact allow those savings to happen would require such a tremendous expenditure of carbon and energy in order to, so that it's sort of racing itself. We need to build this infrastructure so that we can save ourselves from building this infrastructure. So he's wrapped in this. I think the whole mechanism is wrapped in this.
It's important to note he used the word allegorical and not algorical. I'm trying to explain that. Sorry. I think to a certain extent the issues that you're articulating about positions of subjects and objects and individuals in relation to sovereign states and finding them in the interstices and in the processes that produce them is a lot like the middle voice in English, where you say, for example, it used to be in English, but not so much anymore, where you say, I grew up. There's no transitive ground there. Mm-hmm. Excuse me?
There, your mic went up.
Oh, sorry, it was incredibly profound. I was saying that it's analogous, the sorts of issues that he's talking about, relationships between states and sovereign states and subjects, and working in the interstices about this being about mediation and about processes and kind of undercutting a transitive grammar of subjects acting upon objects in the world, which is something that Baudrillard wrote about in the 1960s as something that had disappeared, essentially, is analogous to the middle voice that operates in certain languages, particularly in Greek and ancient Greek, but also in English to a certain extent, which is we have an expression like, I grew up. There is no proper subject or object in that statement. the subject that is able to articulate that position is in that position because of a process that made the subject into a subject that could make that particular statement.
I'm actually reminded, there's a, am I shut off? Did I get, okay. There's a Borges story, Ukbarv, the study, the way in which the study that has no, only has verbs. Right, and he's sort of an ethnography of the society of verbs, and this is why I sort of see this as well. But you know, maybe and perhaps to contradict the point I've made just a little bit, and to Daniel invited me to say something about addresses. The way in which I deal with this question of address within the address letters, in terms of these sort of massively granular and universal addressing schemes, and to take, it's like IPv6 is just a sort of already you know at hand, but it doesn't necessarily have to be IPv6, right? So, as you know, we've run out of IPv4 addresses. I mean, they're still there, but they've all been allocated to the RIRs. And even within the theoretical address space of IPv4, it's only about 300, about half the world, 3 billion world's population. So, IPv6 works out to something, 7 billion people, 128 address strings, works out to about 10 to the 23 addresses per person. Now, if you wanted to assign an address to every single thing you ever came in contact with over your entire life, every pen, every piece of lettuce, every whatever, you could never possibly exhaust 10 to the 23. It's roughly the number of grains of sand on the planet. So you begin to think, so everyone has a portfolio of addresses such that each one of us could apply an IP address to every grain of sand. So, but this would be impossible to do, right? It would be strange things to do, but, you know, people done stranger thing. But at the same time, you could also apply an address principle to something, a relation between things, right? So this cup can have an address, but the fact, this massless relation that it is my cup, can have an address, right? And then where the water comes from, the lake in which the water comes from, the person who brought me the cup, all these sort of relations of these things, sort of, you talk about the hops of relations from any particular hiacity, each one of these having an individual address shifts not only what we want to think about in terms of the way in which the stack might see the space of position in which a user might enter into as something that's not even necessarily something with mass or discrete, but a relation between it, and opens up a space of composability of design, which I call deep address, which would be, as I said, you could never possibly use up 10 to the 23. If you're doing relations of relations of relations of relations, you could use this up instantaneously, turtles all the way down. So somewhere between never and instantaneously is this design space here as well. It's somewhat different, I think, problematic than the transitive, but I do want to sort of indicate that the space in which these even the subjects might enter into, are ones that are themselves purely relational.
Okay.
Graham Harman can, you know, go take a piss. Yeah, you can.
All right, on that note.
Ask me a question.
Yep.
I will ask you a question.
As a moderator, I think I'm entitled to get one question, or like from you.
Yeah.
I deeply apologize for my oversight. No, okay, yes. A question for you would be one that had to do with how the design elements that started in the desert end up back in the desert.
Right. So, meaning?
Meaning, how does that closure, that recursivity, operate in that particular set of properties that you're tracking? Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I don't necessarily agree that they end up back in the desert. I think that the desert, the figure of a space that is partially, you know, unmapped, or the idea that we need to project our hopes and desires into a space that feels unmapped, as you know, in comparison with the space that we, you know, try to change right now, that produces that metaphor, as it were. And it also is a metaphor for notions of standardization, of international regulation, you know, the expectations that are, you know, existing around, you know, certain issues of modern governance. And the notion that, you know, something like a failed state, for example, is really a geopolitical designation handed out by the West to its others. Mm-hmm. And there's particularly in Africa, there's a lot of developments that show that, you know, Western statehood, or the level of statehood that makes, you know, Western institutions possible, is never going to happen anymore. So the development is fundamentally into another direction. And, you know, a country like Cameroon, which sports the domain name extension .cm, has a booming sort of internet industry based on typo spotting, which means that people mistype .com into .cm. Yes. And then they end up into some Cameroonian website. You could say that's another version of the Nigerian scam, right? But I'm not sure whether that will always be the case, as the infrastructure in these countries, you know, becomes slowly but surely kind of more reliable. So it's also a matter of sort of relocating, you know, the idea of a localized internet to spaces where we might have a personal relationship to our data and a more personal relationship to our tools. Right now at the Sandberg Institute in Amsterdam, where I teach, people are building their own, you know, long distance antennas, that sort of stuff. And it feels like it's tinkering, etc. But it turns out that all these the parts that, you know, the antennas are made of, are made in such a way that they can't be self-made or replaced by yours, so you have to buy them, etc. And they find these kind of circumventions around them, and it has this sort of, you know, Mad Max kind of quality to it. But it also has a quality to it that is kind of much more personal, I think. So, you know, I'm not saying that this is already the personal geopolitical, but it's definitely like on that road. Yeah.
Can I say one thing about the deserts?
Yeah, sure.
I began with this note about Schmidt and the distinction that he and, coincidentally, the U.S. military make. You know, the land, air, sea, and cyber is his fourth thing. Now, you know, in the traditional story around this is that, and Virilio, you know, pulls this and pulls so much from Schmidt, is that the land is the site where there is this formal gridding and striation and segmentation and subdivision. And so the loop topology of Westphalia can be held because there are natural features to be organized. Plus, this law is chthonic into site, because we're land based. Whereas the sea is open, flat, the glacial, you know, the open glaciers of the sea, and so the movement is distributed in this way. And so both Schmidt and Virilio argue that it's with air warfare that the land becomes the sea. That by being able to move over the land and to see the land and to move through it in the way in which you're used to sort of over the water, that it becomes ocean-like. But I think what's interesting of the desert in this way, as well, is a place where the land, where it's another way in which the land itself has this kind of open feel, and yet and that's why it's such an appropriate site to talk about the ways in which the grids that are overlaid on it are not ones that are drawn from the natural features or the permanent occupation, they're ones that are coming in from somewhere else. And it's the layer that I think is the exactly precisely the geography that we're talking about.
And it's moving. Okay. On that note, and also to take us actually back to another point made by Daniel, the point of love, I would like us to show a little bit to the speakers right now.